Good morning. Welcome to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Gredick, your host. Delighted to have you with us. And we've got another in a special series. We're very pleased to have now have the third candidate for the U.S. Senate race, Republican primary, in studio, one Kelvin King. Good morning, sir.
Hey, good morning, Steve. Happy to be here.
All right. Great voice. So that means I don't have to do anything. I just let you talk. Instead of me trying to give a paragraph or two introduction, I thought this time I'd just ask you to introduce yourself to our audience. Tell us a little something about your history, your personal history, and your background. Then we'll talk about the campaign.
Sure. No problem. I'm a U.S. Senate candidate, Republican. I'm Georgia born and raised. I'm an Air Force Academy graduate. I'm an Air Force veteran. I own a construction company right here in Georgia. And I'm a father. I'm a husband. And right now, we just need someone that's a complete candidate to be able to run and defeat Raphael Warnock. I was born in Macon, Georgia, back in 74, a year after Roe v. Wade. My mom was only 15, so I was clearly unplanned. And I just thank God that they saw value in my life, which informs my position when it comes to abortion. I'm very pro-life. My parents did marry and moved up from Macon to Cobb County. I was raised up here in Cobb County. And unfortunately, this was the mid-80s. My father got caught up in the drugs, and there was domestic violence, and he left the family. And it was a tough upbringing. But my grandmother, thank God for grandmothers, as I always say, she helped the kids out up in Atlanta. She gave us food and money, and I was able to finish high school. I was in the gifted and talented program, and I graduated with honors, and I got that appointment to the U.S. Air Force Academy, and my life changed after that. In the Air Force, I was a contracting officer, so my job was procurement. So I know government procurement and government financing very well. And after I served my 5 years in the Air Force, I got out as a captain to go into corporate America. I wanted to see what this whole American dream thing was all about. And I started my own construction company 10 years ago from my bedroom, moved to my basement, and now I own a building near the Braves Stadium. And I think I'm living my version of the American dream at this point.
You know, I think that's important. You know, people in construction, they build things. They do things. And that's important. We need more of that in government, people that, you know how to make a payroll and know how to balance a budget. Okay. With that said, got a good life, sounds like. Got a good life. So why in the world would somebody with a good life want to run for U.S. Senate?
Well, I mean, you have to work with grit to create that good life. You know, good lives don't come without adversity. And, you know, right now in our country, I think we need more and more examples of appreciating our country, but understanding that you have to work your butt off in order to achieve. And that American dream is what we all want. And I'm very, very concerned that the American dream is at risk right now, especially with some of the policies that's being pushed by this administration, just the overall climate that we have in our country. And I want to make sure that the American dream is protected and preserved for future generations. That's the theme of my campaign. And I think the American dream is comprised of three tenets. I call it the three-legged stool that holds up this American dream. It's freedom and it's opportunity and it's American exceptionalism. I didn't say perfectionism because America hasn't been perfect over the years, just like we haven't been perfect in our own individual lives over the years. But we do press towards the higher calling, and we want to make sure that we do appear and promote the best that's within ourselves and within our country and our society. And I think that's what America's all about. And I want to push policy to make sure that that American dream can manifest in each and every one of our lives. And you know, my platform is basic and straightforward. It's strengthening our economy. It's prioritizing our national defense and our security, and it's protecting our constitutional rights. And we can talk more about that, but that's the summary of why I jumped into this race. And I feel like I'm the strongest candidate that can win against Raphael Warnock.
We're going to take a break. We're going to jump right into everything. When we come back, we got Kelvin King, candidate for U.S. Senate, in studio. We're on 1330 AM, FM 106.3. We're streaming live to our website and also on WLBB Facebook. Stay with us. We got a lot more coming up.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. you've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at tanner.org.
As a graduate of Oak Mountain Academy, I've found that my experience on the mountain prepared me beyond all expectations. As a junior at Auburn University, I approached my studies with great confidence thanks to what I learned at OMA. When I think back on my time on the mountain, I think of my teachers. Their genuine love and concern for me as a student was always evident, and now, as an adult, I still foster those relationships. I'm Carly Robinson, an Oak Mountain Academy alum. Visit oakmountain.us to see how you can offer your child an amazing opportunity to be a warrior.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. We're very honored to have in studio Kelvin King, candidate for U.S. Senate in the Republican primary. Okay, let's start it off. When Joe Biden took office, the average price of a gallon of gas was $2.19. Now it's around $4. Price of a barrel of oil was $49. Now it's around $100. Also, when Joe Biden took office, inflation was 2%. Now it's at 8.5%. Of course, those numbers vary a little bit. So what impact do you see this on Americans?
Yeah, it's definitely a bad situation that we're in. I can throw a couple other stats out there at you. I mean, frankly, this inflation is here to stay. Biden lied when he said that it's transitory. It's not transitory. It's here. It has roots, and we've got to work to get out of it, and it's going to be painful. Almost 40% of every dollar in circulation right now was printed within the last year. That is just an amazing stat to me. And a family is paying $433 more dollars per month than they did this time last year. That equates to about $5,200 a year that families have to either find or cut from their budget in order to maintain the same standard of living that they had just 1 year ago. This has been a problem for several months. Early last year, we were raising the alarm on this crazy spending. When we passed their American Rescue Plan early last year, and then the infrastructure bill that followed it late last year, these are contributing to this debt that we're in and the inflationary period that we're in, and it's going to be here for a while. And you know, frankly, I say if you find yourself in a hole, you have to stop digging. In terms of solutions, we need to first replace Raphael Warnock with a solid conservative like myself who will control spending. And secondly, we've got to vote down on any future spending bills until we get our own house in order. In fact, I believe that our government needs to trim down because that's one of the costliest areas of our economy. And we do have room to trim. I have ideas on departments that could be cut back. And as a former contracting officer in the Air Force, I understand that we can also reallocate or deobligate funds to put them into areas that are needed, or to just put them back into the Treasury, because we definitely need to cut down on our nation's debt.
Okay. When Joe Biden took office, the U.S. Customs and Border Patrol had reported 405,036 total encounters for fiscal year 2020. The CBP fiscal year runs from October to September. Now for fiscal year 2022, year to date, the number is double, 805,157 total encounters. We're not even at September yet. How dangerous is this for America?
Extremely dangerous. The numbers are going up because people see that that we're not enforcing our laws. I believe that we are a country of laws. If you don't have strong borders, and if you don't have a strong military, you don't have a strong and sovereign country. And we've got to secure our borders. We've got to stop this influx or this infiltration of unvetted people into our country. We are already in a situation where we've got to figure out how to get out of our debt in this crazy spending, and then you want to add millions of people on top of it that we don't know their concerns. We don't know what their goal is by coming to our country. And you know, when I talk about securing our border, you know, it's not just a Republican talking point to me. It's personal. I mean, I'm a general contractor, and I do work for our government, and I submitted a bid to build the border wall a few years ago, back in 2017. I didn't win the bid, but I did submit it to try to build it, and I had some cool ideas. But that's how important it is to me. I don't just talk about it; I put money behind it. And you know, with Title 42 going away, I believe on May 23rd, that's gonna amplify, increase exponentially the number of people that are jumping across our border, infiltrating our country, and we just can't have it. We need stronger politicians. We need stronger representatives that's going to say no to this administration and protect our country and our country's future.
When Joe Biden took office, no American soldier had given their life in Afghanistan in the previous 18 months. With the pullout from Afghanistan, 13 American soldiers were killed and 28 were seriously wounded. Hundreds of American allies were left behind, along with $83 billion worth of military equipment. Yeah. What's to become of the Taliban?
Well, right now, we just opened the door to allow the Taliban to take over Afghanistan, which was a travesty, in my opinion. You just gave all the stats. Essentially, this is what it boils down to. It boils down to the Biden administration has shown weakness globally. They've shown that they're willing to bow to the leftist agenda. When you show weakness across the global stage, it will empower bad actors. And that's all that's happened here in Afghanistan. We show weakness by allowing the country to be taken over by the Taliban. Now Russia has become emboldened, thinking that this is like the Obama years when they took over Crimea. Now this is our opportunity to really take over what we want, and that is all of Ukraine. And Putin took advantage of it. And you see what's happening right now. Thank God that the Ukrainian people have love and grit and heart, and they're fighting for their country a lot stronger than anybody anticipated. And we need to back them in their efforts in terms of not boots on the ground, but, you know, equipment and intel and that sort of thing to allow them to be their own sovereign country. You know, what we want to try to do is we want to promote democracies around the world as often as we can, especially democracies that border a adversary like Russia. And if we show weakness and continue to show weakness, we'll see more of these types of actions. I mean, you see right now, Taiwan is watching what's happening, our response to Russia's invasion of Ukraine. And, you know, their mouth is watering. They're licking their chips. They're licking their lips in anticipation of jumping into a situation with Taiwan. And that's definitely not what we want. Our country is in a position where we've got to make some serious decisions. We've got to decide, do we want strong elected officials that's willing to stand up to our enemies, or are we willing to settle for, in my opinion, flimsy backbone representatives like we have right now with Raphael Warnock that allows the Biden administration to operate inefficiently and dangerously without calling them out?
To be more specific, you know, Biden Warnock's policies are really pushing Russia, Iran, Afghanistan, and Communist China closer together. I mean, this is a real threat not only for us, but it's for Israel and the Republic of China on Taiwan. I mean, the world is much more dangerous.
For sure. You see that. And I don't want to speak things into existence, but you do see Russia and China and Iran having conversations. And, you know, we've got to hold people accountable when they are bad actors. One of the positive things out of this is that NATO has shown a little bit of strength and towards the Russian aggression. Germany has stepped up to the plate with investing dollars into NATO, and I believe Nord Stream pipeline has been put on hold. These are good outcomes, but the bottom line is that America leads the world, and when America shows weakness, the world becomes more unstable, and that's what we're allowing to happen by us with our very weak position when it comes to global and foreign policies.
During the Obama administration, Russia took over Crimea. Mm-hmm. Now they're taking over Ukraine. Even in the tail end of the Bush administration, they went into Georgia. But they say that they didn't do anything during the Trump administration because of his personality. But it's also arguable that oil was so cheap that they didn't have the money to for these excursions.
Yeah, and if you recall, one of the first few things that the Biden administration did was through executive action was to limit our own domestic production of our energy, and we become more dependent on outside sources for our oil and our energy, and that is the opposite of the way we should be operating as a strong, sovereign America. We should show strength. I do believe that energy security and food security and our own national defense is critical to maintain our status as a world leader. We just need to be a lot smarter and utilize a lot more America First agenda items and proceed as if America truly is the strongest and most influential country in the world.
74 of the top 100 officials in the Biden administration were part of the Obama administration. 60% of the Biden administration cabinet officials were part of the Obama administration. So, is this Obama's third term?
It seems as such. You see former President Obama coming to the White House, and he gets a lot more attention and press than our current sitting president in Biden. Frankly, we've got to first flip the House of Representatives. Secondly, we've got to flip the upper chamber, our Senate. And then we have to hold not just the administration accountable, but we need to start pushing policies to correct a lot of the bureaucracy within our general federal government overall. Those numbers that you just mentioned are staggering, and it shows that we have a left-leaning bureaucratic federal government. And the people of Georgia can help make that change. The people of America can help make that change. I truly believe that we're in for a red wave, but it may not hit Georgia, and I'll explain what I mean by that. It's going to take every single Georgian to go out to the voting booth and vote for the best candidate that could best relay your concerns and that could defeat the Democratic Party.
Our guest this morning is Kelvin King, candidate for U.S. Senate. We're on FM 106.3, AM 1330, and Facebook Live, WLBB Facebook page. We're going to come back and we'll talk a little more about politics when we return with Kelvin King here on the Community Voice.
Health is a journey. It's making better choices, even when it's not easy. It's taking care of yourself and the people you love. At Tanner Health System, we're there for you with every step, with primary care, heart care, cancer care, women's care, orthopedics, surgical services, and so much more. We're dedicated to helping you live and feel your best. So let's get on that journey to health. You've got places to be for many years to come. Find us at Tanner.org.
Oak Mountain Academy has offered a challenging college preparatory education for 60 years. With over 500 graduates, we have maintained a 100% college acceptance rate. Over 90% of our students earn acceptance to their first choice of college or university, and over the past 5 years, our students have earned over $10 million in scholarship offers. Our students are creating a legacy. Come, be a part of our family and create your own legacy today. To learn more, visit us at oakmountain.us.
Good morning. Welcome back to the Community Voice. I'm Steve Graddick, your host. We've got Kelvin King in studio. He's running for the U.S. Senate. Okay. Got some more questions. These are the political ones, so this will be even more fun. Mm-hmm. Senatorial candidate Gary Black has not been hesitant to point out Herschel Walker's past alleged domestic violence. Last week, according to the Washington Free Beacon, Senator Warnock, who was accused by his ex-wife of domestic abuse, moved to seal court records regarding his contentious child custody dispute. How does the Kelvin King campaign, if at all, plan to address these situations?
Yeah, I think that a mere internet search or Google search could pull up a lot of the marred background of my opponent and Mr. Herschel Walker. And I think that's something that people need to look into. You need to know who these candidates are that are running for these offices to represent you and your interests. But frankly, in terms of me and my campaign, we're not so much focused on Mr. Walker's past. But what we are focused on is Mr. Walker's present and the future of Georgia. When you see candidates like Mr. Walker who's running on the celebrity and not putting in the real work to represent Georgians, that's a travesty. The guy, he has not shown that he's available to take the hard questions. He's skipping debates. And he doesn't even want to have follow-up questions when one or two questions are asked. This is not representative of Georgia. These aren't Georgia values or Georgia grit. Mr. Walker has shown that he's willing to pass on his integrity and his character. He talks about having a degree, which was that was false. He talks about his graduating as a valedictorian from high school, that was false. His business ventures that he doesn't own, he misleads the people on that, and he doesn't even show up for a debate last weekend in the 9th district. And his excuse was that he had a conflict. Well, I conducted two events earlier that day. He claims he had one that didn't allow him to show up for the debate. I showed up for the debate with two events. I think what Georgians need to look at is who's willing to put in the work to represent them, who has the best character, who has the best integrity, who has the best ideas and plans. Frankly, I've done over 300 events in the state, well over 300 events in the state of Georgia. I've campaigned in every county in the state of Georgia, all 159 counties. No other candidate in my race has done that, this race, and I've coordinated all 159 counties. This is what the people of Georgia are expecting out of their elected officials or anyone who's asking for their vote. And that's what we're going to do in our campaign. We're going to be the most accessible campaign, and I'll be the most accessible senator representing my home state of Georgia.
Yeah, in the 159 counties, what are the top two issues that people bring to your attention?
What we heard the most, it was called our Uncounsel America tour across the state of Georgia. And what we heard the most, obviously, was this council culture is out of control. And we just need help. We need representation or someone to speak on our behalf to counter this council culture. I met with about 200 business owners, and the main concerns were paying people to stay home and not go to work. The whole workforce situation that we're in is a problem. Let's get people back to work. That brings dignity, and it brings a sense of freedom. And lastly, the supply chain disruptions were really causing havoc in our small businesses. And, that's an area of specialty for me as a procurement officer. I know that supply chains are definitely important to maintain a functional economy. And frankly, the issue, Democrats say that the issue was COVID. COVID caused all this, and that's not true. COVID is an issue, but the problem was our government's response and the policies that came in relation to COVID, shutting us down longer than we needed to be shut down. Those are the concerns. That was the problem. That's why it's so important to put representatives in these seats that understands business and understands foreign policy, that understands what makes America tick.
How much money is coming into the Warnock campaign from outside Georgia, particularly California?
Well, Warnock is the number one fundraiser in the United States right now in terms of a Senate candidate. And his money is coming from outside of Georgia. He's raised over $50 million. And, a lot of people talk about how this race is about money. And we know that that's not true. If this race was about money, then we would have retained our seats. Our prior senator, she pumped $30 million of her own money into this race, and we still fell short. This race is not about money. This race is about the right candidate with the right message, with the right backbone that's willing to represent Georgia and willing to debate Raphael Warnock on stage. There's no stronger candidate than myself that's able to debate Raphael Warnock on the key issues of today and the key issues of Georgians.
It's kind of a roundabout way to get to the question regarding Democratic voters, but as we all know, big tech and the mainstream media suppressed the Hunter Biden laptop corruption story, and it's been estimated that anywhere between 13% and 70% of Democratic voters would have changed their vote, resulting in Donald Trump winning the race. How do you view, you mentioned council culture, how do you view big tech's role in censorship, and particularly in this story?
I think if you are a conservative, if you're a Republican, and if you're on social media, you have experienced censorship, and that is not okay. Frankly, when big tech colludes with the Biden administration to suppress our voices, that's a direct violation of our First Amendment right. That's a violation of our freedom of speech. And, right now, big tech, they're protected by Section 230. Well, the Section of 230 that protects big tech from being sued for suppressing our constitutional rights should be stripped. and it should allow us to sue whenever our First Amendment is restricted. I'm a very, very strong proponent of our First Amendment and our freedom of speech. I think that is the essential element of a free society. And frankly, you know, the Democrats talk about, you know, democracy and we're suppressing democracy. That's not true. They are suppressing democracy because the definition of democracy is disagreement. If you can't disagree, you don't have freedom. And that's not what America is about, and I'm willing to fight for our own freedoms.
You had mentioned at the beginning of the program about being pro-life, so let me throw a pro-life life question at you. In Georgia in 2019, over 21,000 black babies were aborted, and over 6,000 white babies were aborted, yet the population of Georgia is only 30% African-American, so more than three times. Georgia Right to Life attributed this to the targeting of preborn black babies by Planned Parenthood through marketing and location of clinics in Georgia. Would you support cutting off taxpayer funding of Planned Parenthood? And where does Senator Warnock stand?
Yeah, that's a good question. And the short answer is yes. And it's personal for me. I was born to a 15-year-old mother, and I clearly was unplanned, but they saw value in my life, and we believe that God knew us in the womb because the word says it. I fought for my son's life. I fathered a child at 19, and you know, I made the decision to fight for his life because it was a question, and now he's a Air Force veteran just like his daddy. And he works for his daddy's construction company, and he's a fine young man. He's going to take over my company once I become a U.S. senator. So this is personal to me. I am pro-life, and it's just unfortunate. Those stats that you just read, they're just mind-boggling. And what's more so mind-boggling is how Raphael Warnock, who considers himself a pastor of a black church here in Atlanta, and he's pro-choice. And we know that abortion is the number one killer of black babies. It makes no sense. It's insane. And I'm willing to stand up and debate Raphael Warnock on that very issue.
And I failed to thank you and now your son for your service to the cause of freedom and liberty in the United States Air Force.
Thank you, Steve.
Herschel Walker has gotten criticism recently for running as a Republican, and we won't go into that. But have you received criticism for also running as a Republican? Isn't there something inherently racist in saying that all black Americans have to vote Democratic?
Well, let me start. Let me go back a little bit on that.
I must have hit something on that one.
Well, I laugh because I think every black Republican has a story of when they became a Republican. most black families are Democrat. They vote Democrat, which is, I think, is a faulty perspective. But I became a Republican out of college. I was reading about, believe it or not, black history. People like Booker T. Washington, George Washington Carver, and those greats. And I was like, wait, those people, they seem very conservative to me. And, you know, I was taught and raised with certain conservative values, and I became a Republican after reading about that sort of thing. And, you know, when you grew up in a black family that typically votes Democrat, and you say that now you're a Republican, now that's when you begin to debate and defend yourself, and you're going to get it because, you stand out like a black sheep. But, you know, you become a much stronger debater. You become a much more articulate presenter of your opinions when you become a Republican, oftentimes in black families. And, you know, I think this is the right time. This is the right time. If we have the right Republican speaking the right narrative with the right shared experiences and background like myself, this is an opportunity actually for the Republican Party to expand the tent. My wife and I, we actually campaigned very hard for President Trump, and we expanded the tent, got people to flip from Democrat to Republican. That's a secret weapon in my campaign and my candidacy. In the general election, if we can't flip votes, if we can't win the middle, then we lose. I'm the only candidate in this race that has a proven background of winning the middle and flipping votes. Our conversation is typically rooted in three things, and I think all Americans can get behind. My positions are rooted in the Constitution, capitalism, or the Bible. And no one can beat me in a debate as long as I'm rooted in those three things. And that's the strength of our candidacy.
And that's also another three-legged stool, the three C's. Okay, we're going to have to wrap it up fairly soon. We like to think that critical race theory is nowhere to be found in schools in Georgia. course, this is the reason for many of the state parental right bills across America. So what's your position on critical race theory, and how does that differ from Raphael Warnock?
Well, first, I think the education of our children should be in the hands of our parents. In fact, I would push for the dissolution, the dissolving of our Department of Education from a federal perspective. Critical race theory is a theory. It's not proven. It's not factual. It comes from the Frankfurt School in Germany. It's a Marxist approach. It teaches oppressed versus oppressor, us versus them. In America, critical race theory has roots because of our background of overcoming racial strife in our country. You know, there's critical legal theory, critical class theory, but critical race theory is what works in America. And it has no reason or purpose or room to be in our schools, to be in our military, or anywhere where we're trying to influence minds. Right now, we have critical race theory being taught at our service academies, at my alma mater, the U.S. Air Force Academy. It doesn't belong there. The military is not about looking at differences amongst people. The military is about unit cohesion, good order and discipline, about variety of backgrounds coming together to conform to that military standard. It doesn't belong there. It's weakening our military. Our morale in our military is the lowest I've ever seen. And it doesn't belong in our military, nor does it belong in our educational system. And I will fight. In fact, that's one of the first pieces of legislation I would push as your next U.S. senator, and that is to ban critical race theory and transgenderism in our military.
You got to promise me we'll come back and we'll do a whole program on that.
Oh,
I think it's that important.
I would love to.
And I'm serious. I really would love to also. We've only got 2-3 minutes left, so we always like to give any candidate that's from county commission to county school board to U.S. Congress to United States Senate the opportunity to say you were knocking on my door, you saw me at a local grocery store, and you know, you come up, introduce yourself, shake my hands, and you know, I'm in a hurry, I got all these things going on. So I say, okay, I'll give you a minute. Why should I vote for you, Kelvin King?
Well, I would say that you should vote for the Kelvin King candidacy and vote for Kelvin King to be your next senator, because I'm the strongest candidate in this race with the best ideas and proven qualifications, and I know the formula to win. And I think you should ask, what's the formula to win?
What's the formula to win?
Well, the formula to win this seat, it's unique. You got to be born and raised in Georgia. You need to be a veteran. You need to be a business owner or someone with a high degree of business acumen. We need to be able to energize the rural communities in Georgia and the urban communities in Georgia. And frankly, having a perspective and being able to articulate the social issues is going to be critical to win. There's no other candidate in this race that knows these things or that fits those qualifications. We know that the Warnock-Abrams ticket is what we're fighting against. They are the highest funded candidacy. They have the media on their side. And they're running off of a historical race. They're thinking of being the first black senator and the first black governor. And it is important for Republicans to open up their eyes and look at this race with clear eyes. We've got to put a candidate that knows how to debate these social and racial issues, income disparities, voting rights. There's no stronger candidate than myself that can debate these issues. And in addition to that, I have a strong background of knowing business, knowing our defense policies and foreign policy, and I don't have a background that can be exposed and exploited. I've been a Republican for over 25 years. Let's vote the candidate that's proven, that's solid, and that can stand up to the attacks that we know we're going to get from the Democrats.
And the website is kelvinking.com, K-E-L-V-I-N, King, K-I-N-G, of course, .com. kelvinking.com, Kelvin King for Georgia. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Let's win for Georgia and let's win for America.
And we thank you for listening to the Community Voice here on WLBB Carrollton, brought to you by Oak Mountain Academy and Tanner Health System. Go out and make it a great day. You're in tune to WLBB Carrollton.